The story you're about to hear is a confession of a talent tempted, of a painter driven into a darker form of art.
Oh, I just felt that if I can outsmart them, so much the better.
His name is Ken Perrani, self-taught for the most part.
I learned to paint by looking very carefully at paintings in museums. I just felt that if I had paints and brushes, I could do that too. I was convinced.
He learned well. His steady hand, his eye for detail, were often compared to many of the 19th century masters. But Perrani didn't just use his paintbrush to please. For him, his art was also a con.
It was me against the experts. Can I outsmart them again? Can I outwit them? Can I succeed? Can I make a fake and pass it off as an original?
You heard right. Make a fake. Perrani spent a lifetime ripping off art dealers and auction houses by painting fakes so accurate that few could tell the difference between his forgeries and the real thing.
Did you get a rush from doing it?
Yeah, sure.
It was addictive.
Absolutely. Risk is addictive, whether it's gambling or the stock market. It's like going out for the hunt. This here is a Martin Johnson Heed that I painted.
So it's not a Martin Johnson Heed.
Yeah, it's a...
He's not apologetic about his misdeeds. In fact, he's downright proud.
It's something that I'm particularly pleased with.
The detail's amazing.
Thank you. Yeah.
He carefully nurtured his dubious craft in a way many cherish a fine wine, and has now written a tell-all book, Caveat Emptor, Buyer Beware, detailing almost every dirty deal he did.
I mean, you're certainly not asking for anybody's forgiveness here.
No.
You're gloating about it, about getting away with it.
Well, I wouldn't characterize it as gloating. I would say I'm just being honest. To this day, I'm still thrilled with the pictures I could paint.
Perrani never meant to be a forger. He had hoped to be an artist in his own right when he started in the 1960s in New York. But his original work wasn't getting much attention. So he turned to a small Flemish portrait he had once copied out of a book. It became the first fake he ever sold.
As I was approaching the gallery, I started getting very nervous. I was beginning to realize maybe this is crazy, but I forced myself to do it.
His sales pitch was always simple and calculated.
You were very careful not to ever pass your fakes off as real. You went in and sort of played dumb and said, I don't really know what this is. I bought it at a garage sale or I found it somewhere. What do you think? And let them make their own judgments.
In a sense, I guess I got a perverse pleasure out of that. I liked to present the painting and have the expert explain to me what I have.
So you'd stand there watching them go over these paintings inch by inch.
Oh, yes. That was part of the pleasure of the whole thing.
He, of course, is not the first art forger, but Perrani is perhaps one of the more prolific. He learned to imitate an astonishing range of 19th century painters, like maritime artist James Buttersworth, known for the delicate lines on his sails. This is an original Buttersworth. Now, look at Ken's forgery of a Buttersworth.
And that's all done freehand. Nothing is drawn in with pencils or anything. It's actually done with a brush, and you have to have an incredibly steady hand to achieve that. And that's what Buttersworth was noted for. And even that little ship there, if you look very closely, has lines painted as fine as a human hair on it.
And how did you learn how to do that?
A lot of practice.
There's John F. Herring, whose equestrian paintings had a unique look.
This is one of my favorites right here.
Ken copied him as well, right down to the bootstraps.
He took particular care in the boot and the saddle and in the face of the jockey. And it's a very difficult technique to understand and master.
But the crown jewel of his forgeries was a Martin Johnson Heed. In 1994, it went on the Sotheby's auction block as an original. That night, he took home a receipt for $650,000, money to be wired to his account.
Was that your biggest score that you ever had?
On one painting, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's just typical business.
Just typical business.
Yeah.
To you, maybe, not to most people. All these little losses here, yeah, where the paint is just flicked off, you've done all of that on purpose.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And
in it wasn't only the paintings themselves that he forged.
I like the effects of age.
He learned to fake time itself.
But I often like to look at the backs of my paintings and hang them this way.
Because you're more proud of that?
Yeah, yeah. I think that this is an illusion that I like to create. How well can you make something look really old that's all brand new?
He became an expert at faking the forensics of a painting, weathering wooden frames, staining a perfectly new canvas to make it look old.
It discolors through the years, and I learned to simulate that.
So that's all made up?
It's all made up. It's all brand new.
He mimicked chalk marks left by auction houses and recreated stamps from dealers.
That's a new stamp. I make those on copy machines and then stain them with tea and glue them on there. So
you've got a process for everything.
Yes.
Even the nails he used to pin the canvas down were period.
Okay.
But perhaps most important of all is his ability to replicate how oil paint cracks with age. There are patterns, he says, like a spider web, that with heat and the right chemicals, he can reproduce like Father Time himself.
This is a very beautiful example of a portrait with a very fine cracking pattern. And if you look at these closely, you'll see a nice sweeping pattern of them. That's a nice touch of authenticity. It's an ongoing process. I'm still perfecting it today.
He says today because he's still painting fakes. Only now he sells them as fakes, the look of the real thing for much cheaper. But why come clean now? Well, it's because he almost got caught. The FBI had been investigating forgeries at the big auction houses, Sotheby's and Christie's, and had traced a few suspected paintings back to Perini. But he dodged their questions, saying he didn't know the origin of the paintings. He had just passed them along.
Were they ever wrong in any of their accusations?
No.
They nailed it.
Sure, yeah. I mean, it was pretty hard to deny it.
And yet, the FBI never filed charges. Even Perini isn't sure why. All he knows is that now, no one can touch him. The statute of limitations on his misdeeds has run out.
You lied to the agents.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah. but, well, that's, in my world, that's survival. It's part of the game.
As you might imagine, it was no game to those in the art world.
So what is Ken in your mind?
A thief. Essentially, he's a thief on the loose.
Brenda Simonson-Mole is an art appraiser in Dallas. She read Perini's bold confession with disgust.
It does irritate me. I mean, it's bank robbery with a paintbrush.
But if you ask him, he says it's pretty much a victimless crime.
It's not really a victimless crime. It's someone ends up with essentially fool's gold, you know, on their walls.
While he's up front now about his fakes, he left a very long trail. He estimates there are about 1,000 of his forged works still out there, duping would-be buyers to this day.
It's like bumping into an old friend, you know. It's good to see where they've gone in the world.
But don't we all suffer a little from having fakes out there?
I don't think so. I think that I've made a contribution to the art world.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder, as they say. So, whether you see him as a painter or a con artist, Perini himself seems most proud of being both.